Hi everyone, it's Dr. Sam Robbins. Now today I'm going to discuss how hemoglobin A1c is not a very reliable test for predicting high blood sugar and diabetic issues. And today's topic is very important for anyone concerned about their blood sugar levels, including weight loss, as well as who wants to avoid getting diabetes, or at least predict it and maybe even reverse it. And specifically, it's about how current blood testing to see if you have high blood sugar is actually not very accurate. And this is personally a very important issue to me because it also affected my own blood test a few years ago. Basically, I did a blood test and it showed high A1C levels, which put me in the diabetic range. And this was even though my blood fasting glucose levels, as well as my post-meal blood sugar levels, were all very normal, in fact, in the lower optimal range. Now, none of this made any sense because I rarely have anything with sugar, maybe other than one or two pieces of fruit a few times a week, and my body fat is always under 10%. Now, it worried me at first until I did more research and found a fatal flaw with the A1C test that most people, including your doctor, doesn't even know about. So if you're concerned about your blood sugar levels, if you'd like to avoid diabetes or at least help better predict it, please make sure you listen carefully. Now, there are different ways to test your blood sugar and thus potentially predict and or prevent diabetes, in addition to simply living a healthier and longer life by having healthy and optimal blood sugar levels. Now, the first is your fasting blood sugar or glucose levels. And this is the most common, is the fasting blood glucose levels, which is FBG. Basically, you don't eat anything for at least 8 hours and then do a blood test, and then you see your fasting glucose levels. And this is typically done first thing in the morning, and you see it all the time with your regular blood test. Healthy levels are between 70 to 100 milligrams per deciliter, and I actually prefer it on the lower end of the scale. Unfortunately, this way does not tell you how things work in the real world, how your body deals with sugar and food after you eat a regular meal. Now, the next type of test is an oral glucose tolerance test. And in this situation, you're given sugar, about 75 grams of glucose dissolved in water. You drink it, and then your blood sugar is tested at 1 hour and 2 hours to see how your body handles all this sugar. Now, I don't like this method either because in the real world, nobody has like 32 ounces, just 4 cups of soda or something else with that much glucose all at once by itself and without any other food. Thus, this isn't really very reliable in the real world. Then you have a post-meal blood sugar. And this is how diabetics do it, and you probably have seen it. Basically, eat a meal, and then you do a little blood test with a glucometer, and you see what your blood sugar levels are after you eat a meal. Now, I believe this is much more accurate, in my opinion, because this is how the real world works. Of course, the average person isn't going to be doing this, right? However, this is how I do it with my own professional athletes and my clients. And finally, we have the hemoglobin A1c test. Now, this A1c test has become much more popular over the past 10 to 15 years. And this is done because it's thought to be more accurate and reliable than that typical fasting blood glucose. And it's also a lot cheaper and easier than the older oral glucose tolerance test. Basically, A1c is a snapshot, or the average blood sugar levels for the past 60 to 90 days. Specifically, the A1C test measures what percentage of your hemoglobin, the protein in your red blood cells that carries oxygen, is coated with sugar. The higher your A1C levels, the poorer your blood sugar control and the higher risk of diabetic complications. In theory, this makes sense and seems like a better indicator. Unfortunately, there's a big problem with A1C levels that most people won't tell you about, and this includes your doctor. And this is something I personally didn't know at the beginning. Now, the main problem is that how long your hemoglobin survives varies greatly in people. And I've seen this, again, in my own professional athletes many years ago, including myself as well. For example, one study in the diabetes journals showed that the red blood cells live longer than average at normal blood sugar levels. Now, researchers found that the lifetime of hemoglobin cells of diabetics turn over in as few as only 81 days, while they live longer, as long as, in fact, 146 days in non-diabetics, the average person. Thus, this proves that the assumption that everyone's red blood cells live for 3 months is actually false, and that hemoglobin A1c can't be relied upon as a blood sugar marker. Now, in a person with normal blood sugar levels, hemoglobin will be around a lot longer, which means that it will accumulate more sugar over this time. Thus, in normal, non-diabetic people, this will drive up the A1C test results, but it doesn't mean that the person had too much sugar in their blood. It just means that their hemoglobin lived longer and thus it accumulated more sugar. Thus, the end result is that people with normal blood sugar levels often test with unexpectedly high A1C levels. And I bring this up because this is exactly what happened to me a few years ago. In fact, I rarely test myself for only the A1C levels, but I had to do it for a special life insurance test, and then I was flagged as having too high, and thus I was at risk for diabetes. So now I'd like to discuss a more accurate way to do all this, all right? Now, I've always stated that the human body is very complicated, all right? It's wrong to think that one drug or one type of diet or piece of food or one type of exercise or one vitamin or one specific blood test or medical test will somehow magically fix or even predict a health problem. With my clients, I test multiple factors when it comes to determining your true blood sugar health. Now, I typically test for four things: the fasting blood glucose, the A1C, the fructosamine, and then also your post-meal blood sugar. And that's basically three meals daily for 3 days. Now, the post-meal is the most accurate, in my opinion, but also takes more time and effort. I then look at all the averages, the big picture of these four tests. Now, if only one of them is high, then I'm not too concerned. However, if three or four of them are all showing high levels, then we have a clear indicator that your body is not processing sugar correctly at the cellular level, as well as the pancreas health and also insulin sensitivity. Now, you need to take action by making some important life changes and improvements, and you can get more details about this below in the description area. So the point with today's video is that the usual methods of testing for blood sugar are all flawed when used individually. I know many people who have had higher A1C levels while their fasting blood sugar and post-meal blood sugar levels were all great in normal ranges. Yet their doctor warned them about becoming diabetic, and yet these people were living healthy lives. So you need to test all four factors. At least three of them can be done all at once with a simple blood test. You just have to ask your doctor to test for the fasting blood glucose, the A1C levels, and also the fructosamine. All right. And if you want to lower your blood sugar and help avoid or even reverse diabetes, you can also make simple life changes, and you can get all the details below this video in the description area. Now, I've included how my own uncle lowered his blood sugar levels naturally, reversed his diabetes, got off the prescription drugs, and also lost 34 pounds at the same time. If you found it helpful, please give it a thumbs up. And as always, thanks for listening and have a happy and healthy day.